I'm not sure how to start this one, folks. It's episode 253 of the Elmo Audible podcast, and Texas State is now 1-5 against the UTSA Roadrunners. You know, I was thinking about doing that meme after a UTSA win of the, like, coffin dancers. You know the one, right? They got the coffin up on the shoulders and the dancing or whatever. Now I feel like we need that for UTSA because, you know, we all thought there was a good chance that UTSA could lose this game. No one expected what we saw on Saturday. Just a humiliating, humbling, pathetic, disgraceful performance from the Roadrunners. Oh, man, we got a lot to talk about. It's going to be a gruesome, gruesome episode.
Agreed on all points, Jared. Humiliating is the right word. It was despicable. It was putrid. Just absolutely horrendous to watch. Complete no-show from UTSA. A lack of emotion, a lack of drive, a lack of care, a lack of effort, a lack of aggression. There was no urgency. There was no will. There was no reason the Roadrunners displayed to want to win that game over Texas State. And on the other side, you saw this just impassioned, aggressive, angry, pissed off Texas State team punch UTSA in the mouth. UTSA rolls over, puts his tail between its legs, and accepts defeat very, very early on to the naked eye. You know, did not see fight from this team from four quarters. Hell, I don't even know if you saw it for three. It really is an embarrassing loss to UTSA. And I think, Jared, the worst loss in program history is UTSA to Texas State, 49-10. An absolute putrid performance from the Roadrunners.
The thing that bothers me the most, the loss is bad, the score differential is bad, but it's the how of the loss that is really upsetting. And I've gotten to the point where I can flush a loss pretty quickly, right? Like, I've kind of emotionally separated myself from the ups and downs of sporting teams. But this one's really sticking with me, man. It's just... Texas State was the team that played with the Triangle of Toughness brand, not UTSA. I mean, they were like the Monstars that went in and like took the powers from like Larry Bird and Space Jam. You know what I'm saying? And they were the team that could run the ball. They were the team that was mentally tough. They were the team that played with aggression. They were the team that maximized the output from the players. They were the guys that were, you know, undersized and overperforming, right? And UTSA just looked like... they forgot how to play football, man. I mean, you saw zero passion from anyone on the team. You just saw every single play, Texas State played harder than UTSA. I don't think you go back and watch that game and find a single play. Okay, I have one example. Was it Houston Thomas, the tight end, that caught that 44-yard pass?
Yeah, I think it was Houston Thomas. That's right. Yeah,
I think it was Houston Thomas. And that's the only play Houston that Thomas. You can say that UTSA showed more passion, aggression, hustle, you know, determination than Texas State. And UTSA got flagged on that play. It took him back 15 yards. Terrible call. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, it was just that kind of day, right?
Nothing could go right. Even the things that could go right would end up going wrong. Look, Jared, to me, it's so many things wrapped up into one, but really a team that does not know how to play football together yet, does not know how to play together as a football team yet. And the fact that it had to be put on full display on national television, ESPNU against Texas State of all teams, is the ultimate ass kick for the UTSA Roadrunners. And just embarrassing to go out like this. But what I think hurts the most is that not only was this loss so, so brutal because it happened at Texas State, but like you said, Jared, the fashion in which it happened, it almost as if now everything that happened prior, irrelevant. 5-0 don't matter no mo in the UTSA Texas State rivalry. This is the game that lives in infamy, is the 49-10. It's not because what happened, Jared? We are supposed to be leagues. We are supposed to be several calibers, echelons above Texas State. We set the barometer for G5 football greatness in the Central Texas region. And so geographically and just on our caliber, on our playing field of football, us and our peers, we have always considered ourselves above Texas State. Texas State is not one of those peers. But here's the fact of the matter, okay? We are no longer in a different league than Texas State. They won their very first bowl game the same year that we did. And now they have the biggest win in rivalry series history. They are a couple of NFL journeymen away from being nearly on the exact same caliber as UTSA as a football team. They've completely caught up to us. They've completely caught up to us. And so, yeah, I think 49-10 stands so much more because now I think there's a big threat to the undisputed best G5 football team in Texas. It's no longer just UTSA. You can't really say that right now. Texas State is a sweetheart. It's definitely the Cinderella story. And now they're the favorite, I think. But with the Sun Belt Conference Championship and a couple of NFL journeymen, they've essentially achieved everything UTSA has on their turnaround. So I'm not
willing to go that far yet myself. It's brutal. They beat UTSA. They got a lot more work to do to accomplish all that UTSA has, right? They've still never been ranked. They've still never won a conference championship.
They need
the conference championship.
Right? I think they need the conference championship.
There's a lot to be done. And this team is totally capable of doing all that for sure. But also, you know, the continuity over several seasons as well will be difficult, right? They're going to have to hang on to Kenny the way that UTSA's been able to hold on a trailer too. So we'll see how that plays out, right? Kenny's got a good spot, dude. I mean, he's a god there now, right? Pick and choose, right? A good job like Trailer has chosen to do. So we'll see how that goes. But you know, it was interesting too. GJ Kenny said a lot of interesting things in his post game press conference, but he brought up the fact that we've got this one over UTSA that's going to help us in recruiting so much, like two or three times, right? So that would be fascinating to see, right? Do recruits see a momentum shift, right? And recruits have very short-term memories, man. That's why you see, like, you know, I guess Miami's caught up, but like Nebraska's like struggled to recruit for so long because these kids don't remember when Nebraska was good, right? And it's not like it's been a long time since UTSA was good, right? But it's just like recency bias is huge in recruiting, right? Recruits are big on vibes, they're big on momentum. So there's going to be, you know, potential secondhand effects, right? From this loss for UTSA. But I have more immediate and pressing concerns for the Roadrunners than looking at that big picture stuff. Because this is a team that needs a lot of work to even get to a
there's
bowl
a
game
lot,
at this
Jared,
point.
Jared, there's so much to be done. This is a team that we saw take no steps forward from week one to week two. What we thought was just a real mental bloop, a big mental collapse against Kennesaw State in week one, is now pointing to be really serious issues that this team has not solved or has not figured out yet. And a lack of snaps, a lack of maturity, a lack of experience on this team. One thing that Trailer was pointing to a lot in his post-game presser was the Texas State's experience together versus UTSA's, this formation of UTSA's roster. Whatever it is, dude, we just saw a very, very immature team that does not have the resolve to play through their mistakes and to still continue to put very good football out there, even after a couple of bad plays. But the team gets derailed almost instantly. There were a lot of plays, Jared, that were just one slip away, a little bit overthrown, or a dropped catch.
A lot of those.
Right. One guy just being a step off, you know, on defense or failing to make the tackle on the first or second contact on defense. There were a lot of those things that were just one small adjustment away. And instead of seeing that glass is half full, Jared, our players were like, well, damn, we just don't have today. We just can't do it today. And we saw them kind of tap out, give out early. That was the hardest thing to see. That was the worst thing to see. But this is a team that does not have the resolve to play through their mistakes. The experience isn't there. The maturity isn't there. And just like last week, more so by way of penalties last week, this week an actual way of performance, I think, despite us having 10 penalties both last week and this week. I think against Texas State, it was more performance-based that a few small mistakes snowball, in this case, to the worst loss in program history.
It's performance, but it's also facing an opponent that has the talent to take advantage of that, right? Like when Texas State is out there throwing to was it Chris Dawn, the sophomore receiver's name, the real short guy? You know, UTSA misses that first tackle 5 yards off the line of scrimmage, and that guy's gone, right? Kennesaw State didn't have any players that could do that, right? So I think that's a big part of it, too. I think a lot of those, you know, mistakes and stuff against Kennesaw State, they just weren't not a good enough program to really capitalize on it. And there's going to be a lot of teams on the schedule for UTSA that are going to be the same way, right? You can kind of get away with some of this stuff if you're playing Charlotte, you're playing Temple, you're playing Tulsa. But Tech State, I mean, they're legit. They're a super strong, talented team. And those small mistakes get amplified big time. But I do agree, though. I think it's much more of a mental thing than a football thing. Like, I think most people agree UTSA is better than this 49-10 showing they had against Tech State. I think even Tech State fans would tell you that, right? I think most of them are probably caught off guard by that score as well. But I think it's a lot harder to fix a team that shows up and looks unprepared and like they don't care if they win or they lose and they don't have any pride in how they play. It's a lot harder to fix that than, oh, like I should have picked this guy up in zone coverage instead of the other guy, right? Or I shouldn't have blitzed because this running back was going to release on a route, on a late release, okay, and he's going to be wide open. You know what I mean?
Do you have an opinion or do you have a feeling of which one of those that of the teams did you see on Saturday and lost? Did you see the resilient UTSA team that was more of, oh, I didn't catch this guy? Or did you see that first team that was, you know, really checked out, didn't seem to care for the bigger why of a whole team and a culture?
It was like from the jump, they didn't look that interested to be there. I mean, we mentioned this in our Patreon instant reaction, but like Texas State's first stop, they had a sideline shot and their sideline was going nuts, man. They like, they were so fired up. And for UTSA, it was very much just like the reaction you would see for just another football game, right? And I hate this term, I hate it, but I'm gonna use it anyways. For Texas State, it was their Super Bowl, and it should have been their Super Bowl, and it should have been UTSA Super Bowl, right? Like, this is one of the biggest games of the year, and for UTSA to come out flat and not put up a fight really at all is so concerning and baffling.
Jared, this game was completely written off all fall camp, all preseason long by Jeff Traylor and all of the UTSA players, which I get it. We want to say the right coach speak and team speak things, and we want to say we're focused on 1 week at a time and we're focused on week one and we're focused on Kennesaw State. But I also think it's okay to be transparent in the fact that you do care a lot about that matchup and just say, that's a big game. You can say we're focused on week one, but we know that's a big one on the schedule, right? But they're almost so dismissive about it that I wonder that it makes the team subconsciously sort of look past Texas State or to treat that game like every other game on their schedule. I don't know that you can do that. I don't know that in a game with as much stake as it has and as much passion as it has, I think you have to be transparent and know, yeah, we care a hell of a lot about this game, right? And we need to go out there and put our best foot forward because we know that they are going to come and punch us in the mouth. We know we're going to get the best version of Texas State. You have to match that energy. And I felt like you got that sort of energy from Texas State. You did not get that energy from UTSA. And look, those guys had it circled on the schedule who wanted it more. And I'm not saying UTSA has to treat Texas State as if they're the most important team that they're going to play throughout the entire year. But damn it, you should have that game circled and scheduled, if not for the sake of recruiting and recruiting only, just how G.J. Kinney was bragging about in his postgame presser. We care about this win just for the sole sake of getting the guy that they want. Jared, we've been talking about UTSA long enough that we've seen the days of of Texas State recruits, quote-unquote, posing in front of the Alamo. And that's stirred up a lot of controversy with UTSA fan. That's our Alamo. How dare Texas State have their recruiting graphic have the Alamo in it, right? That's what this comes down to. That's what this is about. And so, yeah.
While UTSA never really mentioned Texas State by name that often leading into the season, they sure made it a point of emphasis to say, like, our goal is to start strong, to start hot, right? Because they're talking about the playoff and you can't have a slip up, right? Like they've tried to get more guy snaps, you know, in the early season. Jeff Traylor made the mention of in the past, they've treated it of like out of district play for a high school team. So they said all the right things, right? While they didn't say Texas State, I mean, it was obvious to anyone, like, this is the game that you really have to win out of conference, you know, to get that opportunity at the end of the season, if that's what you want. But man, it did not look like they really backed up those statements at all last Saturday. And it's just really telling. You hear GJ after the game saying, two things that really stood up to me, right, was first, you know, they admitted that they tried not to put too much on film in the Lamar game. And he said even on special teams. That was crazy to me. But even more shocking is he said that in their offseason, every roster move they made, you know, transfers they're bringing in or whatever, they asked themselves, will this player help us beat UTSA or not? That's wild. I don't think I've ever heard a college coach say that. Not Ohio State talking about Michigan, not Texas talking about Oklahoma. It's very, very clear that Texas State cared way more about this than UTSA did.
For a year.
And the results showed in the field.
They've been preparing for a year, if not 2 years, you know, the whole time he's been here. That is insane to imagine constructing a roster to beat somebody. But when you think about it, like what we were talking about earlier, the barometer of being a successful G5 program in the state of Texas, Jeff Traylor and the Roadrunners has set over the last three seasons. You know, they've showed what a mid-major, quote-unquote, can do. And so Houston has done several times over the last two decades. We can look at that as well. Texas State, no reason for 100 years, hasn't been in that conversation. Now it has an ability to be in that conversation. Yeah, why not? Try to beat UTSA. That is the bar for where we want to be as a G5 program in this region, recruiting for the same guys. That's who we need to be.
You know, I know that it's not a lot of the same guys on the roster, but I've been thinking about this game and thinking back to the 2022 season. It wasn't UTSA's best team. The 2021 season was their best team. And I don't think it was their best coaching job. I still think that the COVID year 2020 was their best coaching job. But I think 2022 was the most impressive run for the Roadrunners, because going into the season, they knew they were going to get the best shot from everyone on the roster, right? And they didn't flinch, man. They stood there and they took punches and swings. Like, teams are pulling out crazy stuff to try to upset the Roadrunners. And never once did that team flinch, man. They were rock solid. They played good football and they were just resilient. And that's the opposite of what we saw from UTSA on Saturday. I mean, they look shocked the way that Texas Tech came out and like their level of passion, energy, right? Those 2022 Roadrunners would have matched that, right? Because they had those vocal veteran leaders that it's clear this team doesn't have them right now, right? There is no way that UTSA gets out to the start that they did on Saturday. And then Frank Harris, Rashad Wisdom, Josh Cephas, you know, whoever is on the sideline and just letting that happen, right? They'd be grabbing face masks, yelling at people, like getting the troops rallied. And I don't know if anyone was doing that on sideline for UTSA on Saturday, but if they did, they didn't do a very good job of it because it did not reflect in the style of play.
Not at all, not whatsoever. What you saw was a team underneath those bright lights, underneath that packed stadium and that very hostile away crowd environment for the very first time. Right, they looked starstruck because it was rowdy as all hell.
Yeah, great atmosphere for sure.
Stadium, it was jumping in there. It was ferocious. It was 90% maroon and gold Bobcats fans.
Yeah, dude, that's UTSA. Another thing I want to say, man. I mean, I walked in that stadium and I looked around. I was like, "We're gonna lose. Our fans didn't show up. They don't care about this game." It was pathetic, dude.
It was bad. It was poor.
How many fans did Texas State bring to the Alamo Dome last year? 10,000? And what did we bring to Texas State? 1,000? 1,500?
1,000? 1,500? 2,000? Probably 2,000 max. It was absolutely a parallel of what we saw on the field. No, honestly, man, you saw a team that looked like it had never been in a crazy, hostile college football environment before, which is kind of true if you think about it. Besides the game against Tennessee, which of course they had the people there, but of course the volume wasn't in there when these guys came out in the second half or whatever it was, third quarter. But the fact of the matter remains is, like, besides the blew out Texas State I don't know that UTSA's really had like a totally packed crowd last season. That was at the same level
You know,
of rowdiness and ruckiness this year. Like
that
it
Tulane
was,
crowd wasn't intimidating. Like it was a packed
no,
house, but
absolutely
they
not.
weren't very loud. Yeah.
Absolutely not. And it felt like it was the first time they had been in this environment, right? And I was thought there, I sat there and I thought about it. I was like, man, I don't know if they've ever even like seen really crazy crowds, at least not this starting roster before. They were definitely starstruck. They were blinded in the light. And it came out of the style of play how shook the Roadrunners were, man. Absent, right? Jared, it was crazy because you started the game with fourth down defensive stops from both teams on each opening possession. And I was
Well, you
like,
get an
this has to be
interception
the
from
most.
UTSA even before that. I mean,
Dude, I was
like
like, this
that
must be
was
the
super
most.
concerning. They start the game with an interception. They've got amazing field position and they can't score, right? You should at least get a field goal there easily. And then you then get a fourth down stop on the next Texas State possession, and you're like, oh man, this defense, man, they look awesome, right? They're rolling. And then, you know, you have
That's right.
Willie McCoy flying down the sideline, perfect back shoulder fade from Owen McCown, one of the best throws he's had as a Roadrunner. And it just like hits Willie in the face, hits his hands and everything. Drop. They got a punt out of their own end zone. To me, like once that pass was dropped, like that's when I knew, yeah, I don't know how this is gonna go, right? That
I
was a
mean,
really bad drop. Really bad. And we saw a lot of drops from the receivers, all the what, four or five, right? That's one of the things that we mentioned kind of in passing in the season preview, right? Is like we've never had to worry about drops at UTSA under Jeff Traylor, right? They've had rock solid hands all throughout the tenure. And now we're seeing these drops that are preventing third down conversions, that are preventing touchdowns. It's really hard to come back from that. Really, especially when you can't run the
really.
ball. It's really hard.
Well, Jared, it's like what you were talking about, man. A team that can take advantage of those mistakes. UTSA makes so many mistakes. Texas State is so talented and so deep that they're able to take advantage of it. And you think about UTSA's wins over the years and these teams that are actually at their caliber, it always comes down to one possession,
Yeah.
minimizing mistakes. The only teams that UTSA is able to get away with making a lot of mistakes against are ones that they have a big talents discrepancy against. And that just isn't the case with this Texas State team. And UTSA, I think, subconsciously maybe thought that it still was, and maybe thought that we could go out there and just
It's a good
have
take.
our way with Texas State, as we
Good
always
take.
have. We're the better team,
Yeah.
we're the bigger, badder team. We don't buy the hype, they only won eight games. And here we are now. On the other side of this, like, oh no, Texas State can definitely keep up with UTSA. So much so that UTSA cannot afford to make mistakes against them the way that they did.
Right.
Jared, we saw those drop passes. We saw some missed throws by Owen McGowan, but I don't think he was as bad as his receivers were as far as the passing errors go. Neither of them were very clean. Neither of them were very tight. Neither was UTSA's running attack. But yeah, you talk about that interception on the opening drive. UTSA takes over on the 40-yard line, Texas State's 40-yard line.
God, man.
And we get a net total of 2 yards of offensive advancement. And it's a turnover on downs. It's a turnover on
I'm
downs.
just I
And,
like wait like when is the right point in this podcast for me to start ranting about the offensive line? It's been on the tip of my tongue the whole time. Should I go
well,
in?
look,
Should I start?
what's the biggest issue that happened for UTSA on Saturday in the 49-10 loss against Texas State? What was the biggest issue? Was it
Effort.
the
Effort.
hmm.
Effort. I am so embarrassed by the performance of that offensive line. I mean, it even the veterans, man, they Oh my God, dude. It was gross, right? They're hardly firing off the football, playing with no aggression, standing straight to the line of scrimmage, no pad level, not getting out to open space and running and blocking on screen passes, not making their way up to the second level. The offensive line was pitiful. And they were bad against Kennesaw State, but it was so much worse against Texas State. I mean, they just got owned. They got bullied. And like there was one play, I think it was Jalen Garth. I think it was Garth, the right tackle. He was blocking a 225-pound JUCO transfer defensive end. He's got like 100 pounds of weight on this guy, and that defensive end just bull rushes right through him. Are you kidding me? Like, have some pride in yourself. Have some pride in your game. Just so many examples like that. 295-pound defensive tackle throwing Corey Godinet to the ground. And Corey Godinet's like 340. I mean, it's 100% effort at that point, right? They're not moving their feet. They look terrible, Adrian. Terrible. And, I mean, it's getting so bad. I'm like, how long do you let this play out before you make some drastic changes? Put some freshmen in there? Make a coaching change? I don't know. But this is some of the worst offensive line performance relative to the talent that I've ever seen from UTSA. I've seen better offensive lines when they were running out walk-on true sophomores, when they were running out converted tight ends. And these are legit Division I talents on the offensive line. Don't get it twisted, right? I don't think it's a talent issue on the offensive line. I think these guys are good. They can be good. But they are not playing like they care if they win or they lose right now. They don't play like they care to get a pancake block. I don't know if I've seen a pancake block from UTSA this year. It's so disappointing. And nothing else we talk about with this team matters if there's not physicality from the offensive line to run the football. I mean, UTSA's entire program is built around that. It is the top point of the triangle of toughness, right? Physical toughness to run the football, right? They've built this roster to be in 12 personnel, right? They've got like 8 tight ends on the roster, 2 of them on the field almost all the time. If you can't run the football, those guys are a liability, right? They're good players. But, you know, UTSA keeps going to empty back sets on third down. You got 2 tight ends and a running back out there and only 2 receivers. That's not what an empty formation is supposed to look like. You're supposed to have 4 receivers that can burn anyone down the field, right? But if you can't trust your offensive line to get, you know, 2 yards of push at the line of scrimmage, you're left with no choice. UTSA is afraid to run the ball on the first down now. They're throwing on first down every play. And that's why the quarterbacks end up in 3rd and 8, right? Because they can't run the ball. Then they're behind the sticks. And it just compounds and compiles. And it all starts with the offensive line just being able to run inside zone consistently. I mean, I wouldn't mind against Texas if they only ran inside zone. Because this team can't win if they can't execute inside zone. And they need to rep that until they can figure it out, or they can find other guys that can run it. Because you don't have to overpower people to run zone blocking schemes, right? If you're quick and you get to the point and you move your feet and you're aggressive, you can clear enough space for a running back to slip through. But right now, they're just plodding around up there. They're just standing still. It's gross, man. They need some sled work.
So there's some serious questions that come behind that, Jared. You know, when you talk about issues of effort, issues of technique, issues of guys not being low enough at the pad level and showing the aggression and the push, or just basic
understanding stuff.
How to block right, and then, you know, how to block together on different play calls. There's so many different things that we could potentially attribute this to, but Jared, I mean, what about UTSA X's and O's wise as a coaching staff not being prepared for this Texas State team, and how much of effort energy falls back on that as well?
I'm not sure exactly what you're asking.
Like, how much do you point at the staff for, you know, having these formations, these bad play calls, or would you even call them bad play calls, or just sheerly lack of effort?
I mean, there's always better play calls that you can make, right? But to me, I think the problem is much more that of execution than play calls, right? There were a couple questionable calls. I can think of one early failed third down conversion where UTSA ran like 3 guys short of the sticks on 3rd and 8. And I mean, even if Oscar would have caught it, like, there's no chance that he would have got the first down there. So, like, yeah, there were probably like missed calls on that kind of stuff, like pre-snap, but you know, just generally speaking, I don't think play calling is as important as fans make it out to be. I mean, I think you can win with any play in football if every player does their job. And you didn't see that from really any position from UTSA. It's really hard to evaluate their running backs because they don't even have a chance, right? Like they're getting the handoff, and one of the offensive linemen is like in their hip already because they're getting blown back 2 yards off the line of scrimmage by a guy that's 50 pounds lighter than them. So, you know, I'm sure the running backs are doing their fair share wrong as well. But I just feel like if you can't run the football and, you know, you can't protect the quarterback, it doesn't matter what play call you have. Right? It just doesn't matter, right? You can call anything.
So when we look at effort and we look at aggression, how much do you point back to, you know, coaches, head coaches, position coaches being able to get that part of it done?
Yeah, I mean, the coach's job is to get the best effort out of the players, and that's clearly not happening right now.
Right, right.
And you want to have a player-led culture where you have a guy like an Ahufita Maka that can get that line in shape and get them executing, right? But you're not always going to have that, right? And that center position is huge, right? UTC has a new transfer center this year. They're still building chemistry and a bond together. But I mean, honestly, Adrian, I think it's at an individual level at this point. When all of the guys are playing that poorly, I mean, you just got to look inward and say, am I okay getting beat by a guy this much smaller than me? And the answer's got to be no. If you want to win games, the answer's got to be no.
Yeah, we're seeing much weaker individual parts than the sum of the total, right? And it's particularly bad on a quarterback like Owen McCowan, right? I think Jeff Traylor said it best in his press conference that your quarterback can't play good when no one else is playing good around him.
Yeah, so true.
He particularly pointed at the offensive line and the wide receivers.
Right. I will make a small counterpoint, though. I mean, when I rewatched the game, I thought the pass protection was a little bit better than I thought at first because Owen was getting the ball out so quickly, he wasn't letting plays develop a lot of times. And that's fair, right? Based off Kennesaw State, there was a lot of pressure. Dyke State's an incredible blitzing team, as we've covered profusely. But also, I'm sure like that was the game plan going in, right? Get the ball out quick. And they avoided sacks. Texas State didn't get a single sack. But there were some plays where, and that third down conversion that I just talked about, where they had those guys run short of the sticks, Devin McEwen is like pretty much wide open, right, on the other side of the field. If Owen would have took another second and scanned and read the full defense, he probably could have found Devin there for a big play, right? So, you know, I think it's maybe a little bit much, right, to completely write off Owen and Eddie's struggles as like no one else is playing well. While that is true, there was plenty they could have done to be better as well, for sure. Some bad throws, right? Just basic pitch and catch, and both quarterbacks struggle with that at times. Eddie had airmailed one that would have been an easy 15-yard gain. It just went right over the receiver's head. There was one play that had JJ Spark in the end zone. He's 6'4" against like a 5'9" or 5'10" cornerback. And in that situation, you would throw the ball high and let the bigger guy go up and high point it. But instead, I think Owen threw the ball low. And then that Texas State cornerback was able to get underneath it and you know, break that up. So it's just bad everywhere.
Yeah. And so I would agree with you on the count of I thought execution was much worse than actual play calling itself. I don't really have too much of an issue with play calling. Or really the distribution, except for whenever we see a sequence of three straight runs, or whenever we see third down passes short of the sticks, that seems to be sort of a constant. But other than like things like that, and those don't happen every single drive.
Yeah, right? I know.
It's an exception. But they do happen, and they get annoying, and sometimes, you know, in a game like that, they're more glaring than not.
You got to give Texas State credit too, because there were a lot of really good play calls that Texas State sniffed out. They tried to run like a throwback tight end screen to one of the tight ends. And I don't know why I happened to be watching the tight end on that play. And I saw it start to develop where it was clearly going to be a screen. And I watched the Texas State linebacker read that as well. Right. And he followed that tight end. He stayed with him. And then Owen just had to throw the ball on the ground because that was the whole design of the play, was to throw back that tight end. But if the defense happens to read it, you got nowhere to go. Right. So there's examples of that too. And honestly, man, I mean, great play from Texas State defense. They totally proved me wrong. I didn't think that was a very good defense. And they played well. They tackled really well. They were super physical.
They were.
They gave
incredible effort. Out physical. They were just physical. They were physical. They had higher hustle, much higher hustle, much higher physicality, much more aggression. And that's all it takes, I think, is, you know, you have a plan to get punched in the mouth, Mike Tyson, right? And UTSA, I think, got punched in the mouth very early on. You talk about the sideline tackle on the opening drive, igniting that sideline, and just a little bit of momentum turns into a big thing. And yeah, Texas State's defense was stellar. They were also coming off a pretty decent game against Lamar, at least where they got into the backfield a lot and had some big plays happen there, despite letting go of a lot of points. But, you know, Jared, I think it's more so, the lack of effort from UTSA's offensive line, the mistakes, the mental lapses in UTSA's offensive line, big mistakes from the wide receivers on the drop passes that we saw.
I would also say that I didn't think the receivers blocked very well either on the edge. Not the way that we're used to, for sure.
But I also think, Jared, you know, when we talk about the whole thing, we talk about everything being bad, this running backs room just isn't getting it done. And we want to gripe out the offensive line, but I think there's been a couple of run plays in each of these games now that just bad decision making or poor field vision from the running backs, where they seem to be running straight into tacklers, or they seem to be backpedaling or turning back around to go the other side of the field, opposite field. They're doing that a lot, just uncertainty, not committing to the lanes that they're choosing to run in. This is supposed to be one of the most stacked rooms of the UTSA Roadrunners and of the AAC, in our opinion. And you had 76 yards against Kennesaw State. You had 82 yards against Texas State. This is really, really poor running. This running back room should be elite enough to make up for poor offensive line play. And it's not happening that way at all, man. And that, I think, has just been an absolute killer for this offense as far as momentum goes.
The run blocking has been pitiful overall, but there were opportunities. There were some good run blocks that the running back didn't take advantage of. That is true.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I think on those run pass options, there were some times that the quarterback should have handed it off, right? They had a nice, good hole to run into, and the linebacker was looking for the pass, and they still threw it, right? So I think some of that's on the quarterbacks as well, you know, Owen namely, and trying to read that a little bit better. But, you know, when you're watching your offensive line get demolished the previous play, it's hard to have the faith to hand the ball off. But, Adrian, I think you make a fair point, man. I mean, you get 70% of the blame to the offensive line, but I mean, the run backs have to get a little bit as well, because they've had some opportunities they didn't capitalize. They had drops in the passing game as well.
So as bad as UTSA's offense was, I mean, you know, you essentially get 3 total points of offense from your starters through the first half. It's 35-3 at halftime. And then you get a touchdown, I guess, somewhat in garbage time there from your backups.
Yeah, and it wasn't an easy one in garbage time either. They had to go to fourth down to get that one.
We had to fight for it. We had to put us a shout out.
Could have punched it in from the 2-yard line, dude. This is not Roadrunner football. That's never been a problem for this team.
It was just indicative of how the entire afternoon was going for this team. But Jeff Traylor, in his postgame presser, which, by the way, and maybe this is for a different time, but he was a hell of a lot more pissed off after winning against Kennesaw State in his postgame presser than he was after losing 49-10, his worst loss as a head coach at UTSA, in that postgame presser this week against Texas State. I don't know if it was just stunned, humbled, flummoxed, just accepting, humbled, what it was.
Yeah.
But man, I thought he was going to be a little more fired up than he was. He was not fired up. So take that for what it is.
I can't remember. I saw some of the media say that, like, oh, Traylor had seen this coming for weeks or something like that, which maybe there's some truth to that. And maybe explains, you know, kind of a muted response. But I think he was disappointed in his team that they didn't show up at all, right? I think the realization that he doesn't have that player leadership that he's had in the past, and he's probably going to have to be a little bit more forceful with the guys, right? I mean, if the players aren't stepping up and leading this team, then he's going to have a little bit more of a top-down approach, right, to reinstitute the culture, or maybe to institute in the first place, with so many new players on the roster, right? So I think that has some something to do with it. But I would be really curious to hear what the tone was inside race last week, like leading into the game, right? Because obviously, like what we hear on the media side is not like what actually gets said in the locker room. So that I would be really curious to hear and kind of compare the post game reaction to as well.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. So the thing that Jeff Traylor echoed more than anything else in his postgame presser was the most shocking part, according to Traylor, how easy they scored on our defense. I really didn't think that they were going to be able to do it that easily against our defense. Jared, what the hell went wrong for these UTSA Roadrunners to give up 49 points against the Texas State Bobcats in San Marcos?
Adrian, to be honest with you, I was a little bit surprised at how disappointed and I guess like aggressive Jeff was to like point blame in the defense. Because obviously when you give up 49 points, that's not a good day in the office. But they got zero help from the offense and from special teams either. I mean, they started out the game looking great, right? They got an interception. They got a fourth down stop. But then they sent saw their offense do nothing with it. Tech State had some good plays. And they were going to score. I mean, come on. They're one of the best offenses in college football, right? So I just think as the game wore on, I think the defense didn't have the same mental toughness that they've had in the past. And they probably didn't have the same trust that they would get bailed out and the offense would find a way to like crawl back into it. Because when Frank Harris is a quarterback, you know there's going to be comeback every time.
Yeah.
So I do wonder if it was like a lack of faith in the offense. But I didn't think the defense played anywhere near as bad as a 49-10 result would think or would imply, rather. And when you're only getting 20 yards on your punts, I mean, Texas State had an incredible field position on like half of their possessions at least. So, yeah, I was a little surprised about that. I didn't think the defense played as bad as Jeff seems to think. But I can definitely understand why, because there are a lot of easy scores for Texas State, to be fair. And some missed tackles. Tackling was great against Kennesaw State and not so much against Texas State. I thought the defense really struggled with the speed.
I think the tackling and the speed, they got beat, just straight up getting beat. That's for sure. But the tackling, I mean, on a lot of those big gains, maybe not on the touchdown plays so much, but on those big gains that they had, just gashes of open field, they would get by three or four UTSA defenders. And if they had a UTSA defender one-on-one, it was almost surefire that Roadrunners were getting beat. And I saw a lot of guys fail to close in one-on-one open field tackling. Sometimes not even get to the ball carrier in those one-on-one situations. But a lot of times we saw that just diving sort of tackling or just hitting and bouncing off of ball carriers. And so poor effort there. And we know the Roadrunners do not live tackle in practice.
I was going to say the same thing.
In this podcast a lot. They're not ever quite ready for game speed. And I shouldn't say not ever, because Jeff Traylor had a pretty good track of September games his first 2 years at head coach. You talk about that 2021 team, Jared. But for some reason, the last couple of years seem to be a little bit slower in September than their opposition a lot of the times. And a lot of it points to tackling. A lot of it points to mental and disciplinary errors by way of penalties. UTSA commits 10 penalties in each week one and week two performances. So 10 penalties against Texas State after 10 penalties against Kennesaw State just last week. Brutal.
I think the defense is going to be okay. I'm not sweating it that much. I thought they got decent pressure. I saw a lot of people on Twitter saying, oh, the defensive line's playing as bad as the offensive line. I didn't see that personally. I just think Jordan McLeod's a really good quarterback, and he got the ball out quickly. He found his checkdowns and stuff like that. But I feel like they did make him speed up. They made him leave the pocket quite a bit. And I thought the defensive line held up really well in the run game. The linebackers were mostly solid in the run game. The safeties got beat a bit. So, yeah, I don't know, man. I'm kind of conflicted about this defense. Obviously, they're going to look bad against Texas this week, right? Anyone would. But I think they're going to look pretty solid against Houston Christian and East Carolina as well. So
okay.
I'm not going to judge them too harshly because they looked incredible early in the game until the offense and special teams started, you know,
tanking,
crapping up the place.
They need help. They need help. Yeah. They need help. Yeah, I'd agree with you.
It's really hard. If that's how the whole season is going to be, it's really hard to keep that really elite defensive mindset when you don't have a lot of trust in the offense to go and get 24 points that you need to win the game or whatever. So that is something to definitely monitor for sure.
You know, I got the impression that Traylor seemed to chalk this loss up to just bad timing more so than anything else. You know, Texas State experienced, played together a lot, riding high, and we're inexperienced and we're trying to figure things out together. And not in those words, but that's just sort of like the sort of tempo I got. And he did say something along the lines of, you're never as bad as that game looks, and they're never as
yeah, which much I, better. I 100% agree with him on that. Yeah.
Totally, 100%. We know, I think, on 100 games of these two teams playing each other, the 49-10 outcome probably doesn't happen at a very high percentage. But it did happen. But he seems to think, right, that spectrum of errors is a lot smaller than what we saw from the Roadrunners. But Jared, I don't know, the last 2 weeks they've just looked very poor. They looked very sloppy as a football team. They looked very unorganized, very untogether. Extremely immature is a word that we've used a lot. How much of this is fixable? How quickly can it be fixed? Are these problems bigger than just a couple of mental mistakes snowballing into really bad performances? Or is it something larger than that for these Roadrunners?
There's no simple answer to that, and we're not in the locker room. But I've been pretty negative on this podcast. Obviously, you have to be at least 49-10. I still have total faith in Jeff Traylor to get this program where it needs to be, to get this team to where it needs to be. I still think this team can win 8 games this year. I still think they're quite talented. I think we're going to see them improve a lot once they hit conference play. It's disappointing because the tone around the program heading into the season was really lofty. I mean, they were talking about the playoffs mm-hmm. openly. And now you lose to Texas State and you're like, oh, we're still figuring out who we are and all that. It's like, well, that's not what you were saying 2 weeks ago, right? So, like, did you miscalculate? Did you think this team was elite and you were wrong or what? You know, what's the story there? But no, man, I feel like Jeff will find a way to fix the offense. He's an offensive-minded coach. They're going to find an answer there for sure. I think we're going to see a lot of these guys start to get more comfortable. And I really liked what Jeff said today in his media availability. He said, we've installed too much. We've made the offense too complicated. Guys are confused. They're thinking too much. And I have always been a huge proponent. One of the best things you can do on offense is to have a very simple playbook and execute it crisply and to perfection. Right. If they throw out a third of the playbook, I think that's a great idea. I think they should start this week. And I think they need to get to where they can really execute some of those core plays that have been so crucial to UTSA's success in the Jeff Traylor era, right? Running inside zone, running outside zone, running power, running play action bubble screens, running that RPO with the peak of the quick slant. They got to get that stuff down, right? That has to be their bread and butter. And, you know, like I said earlier, UTSA's built their whole program around being able to run the ball and have success in the early downs. And when they can't do that, you're left with a team that doesn't have an identity on either side of the ball, right? So, look, they've been here before. They've got it fixed before. I don't see any reason not to trust Traylor and his staff to make the corrections necessary. I still think this is the most deep, talented roster they've had, top to bottom. They may not have those clear playmakers that they've had in past years, but they have plenty of guys that can go out and make a play, right? And I think they're going to find a way to make it happen. So we'll see. I could eat my words. This could be one of the most disappointing seasons in UTSA history. That's on the table. But until proven otherwise, I'm going to trust in Jeff Traylor to get this fixed. He's an incredible football coach. He'll find a way.
Beautifully said.
The triangle, the triangle will rise again, Adrian.
The triangle will rise again. The triangle will rise again. And you have to believe in that. Look, the guy has a track record that gives you no indication otherwise, right? He is going to get it done. Look, this is the first time that he's really actually fielded an entire roster of his guys and his players at the helm. This is post Frank Harris trailer. This is post Frank trailer. And this is his first game of consequence with fielding his dudes. And so it's a massive, enormous change. I always thought playoff expectations for this team were rather lofty considering how much was changing for a brand new quarterback to come in and have that. I think it's probably an unfair expectation for this offense, yeah. Especially with an all new look passing game, but I get it. You want to win every, you want to believe that you could win every game. Sure. Yada, yada. But was UTSA a little bit too open about those goals? Maybe a little too much during the preseason through fall camp? Yeah, I think so. And look, Owen McGowan said himself during the preseason that he was trying to learn all of the details, finite details and adjustments to make during this or due to this playbook, on this playbook. Jared, yeah, I think they've got to dumb it down. You don't have a 7-year, 8-year quarterback at the helm of your offense and guys that have been running this playbook for 5 years straight that are able to make those adjustments on the fly. Yeah, you got to dumb it down, man. So I fully agree with you there.
And I don't know if this happened with Owen in the game, but I did notice when Eddie came in, he would try to do some audibles at the line of scrimmage, and then like the receiver would be running a different route than what Eddie threw, right? So it's just another example. They probably need to simplify things. Dumb it down, take it slow, take it easy. Or maybe not take it slow. Maybe they should be playing faster. Like play more simple football, play it faster, sure. Right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, I think so. And I think we saw a little bit of, culture pillar violation come to life with the playoff talk for the Roadrunners. Fell massively short of that in the very first game that mattered towards it. How does that impact the mental psyche going forward, I think, is the most difficult thing for this team. Do they feel like they lost what they were playing for, don't have anything to play for this season anymore? So that culture that Jeff Traylor is so known for being so good at having, probably enduring its most difficult test to date now with a team of guys who just got their butts kicked in a game that they overlooked against a team that they overlooked in a rivalry game at that on national TV. Now we're going to be written off by everybody. Do they care about that? Do they care about that enough to pull through and resolve? Or are we counting the days to get in the transfer portal and go play somewhere else? Going to be really, really difficult with Jeff Traylor not having all of those experienced veterans here to lean on to instill that program culture. Triangle will rise again, baby. We've got to be confident that it can.
That's beautiful. Anything else we missed on Texas State? I feel like it's a great place to wrap it up for the recap.
No. Cool. An hour of Texas State was necessary, though. So,
there's not much to preview for the Longhorns, man. Like, we're... I'm going to do some quick Patreon shout outs. We'll do a Cumbia break and then we'll come back and talk a little bit of the Longhorns. But I do want to say thank you to two new Patreon subscribers at the Insider tier. Shout out to Royalty Fortnite and Jacob Garcia. We had a lot of like lapsed patrons come back for the Texas State film breakdown as well, which was kind of funny because traditionally, when UTSA loses a big game or like they've been on a losing streak, like we'll lose slowly Patreon subscribers. But after that one, we saw like a huge uptick of like new subscribers and people coming back. I was like, oh man, people are searching for answers. It's like you get broken up with and you like go to church, right? You're like, what am I doing wrong here? You know what I'm saying? So, dude, but thank you to you guys. Hope you guys enjoyed that film breakdown. I got a kick out of it.
Oh man, that was funny. Yeah, at one point I was like, so us losing to Texas State's actually really good for numbers.
That's not always the case. Yeah,
double-edged sword. No, yeah,
but come commiserate with us. Andrew and I, we didn't have any reception in UFCU Stadium in San Marcos, so we weren't really following our Patreon community chat like we usually would on game day. And then I got out of the stadium and I loaded it up, and I was like, man, this is group therapy. If you want to be in a place where you can vent and do it respectfully and intelligently with fellow diehard fans, that's the place to be. So some of those folks are Board of Trustees members. Thank you to Digiteek, to John Otwell, to Gary and Ruben representing the UTSA Burger King tailgate, Ray Redding and Mimi Apparel, Brandon Grill and the Grail Realty Group, Andy Elizalde, Provision Benefit Solutions. And if you're not a Patreon subscriber, Andy made a new intro song for us to use on Patreon. So if you are a subscriber, you would have heard it for the first time last week. So check it out if you're not. Thank you, Andy, so much. It's so cool to have the community like really build a core part of our brand. It's really, really awesome. So thank you once again. Thank you to Ian McClendon and Seeker LLC, Ryan Squares, Waterman Construction, Javon Townsend, president of the DFW chapter of the UTSA Alumni Association, UTSA Annual Giving, Artisan Vapor and CBD, and Wayne Gonzalez and the Runners Rising Project. So we'll shoot you guys over to a quick Kumia break, and we'll be back in just a few seconds to preview the number 2 Texas Longhorns. All right, guys, we're back. Hope you enjoyed the Kumia break. Not a lot to say about this one, man. It's going to be a very, very, very tough week for our beloved Roadrunners. They are traveling up to Austin to DKR to face the number 2 team in the country, the Texas Longhorns. Definitely a national championship contender. Pretty much a flawless team from what I've seen of them so far. Probably the best offensive coach in college football with Steve Sarkisian calling the shots over there. They've got UTSA's best player on their roster. Trey Moore went down I-35 and joined the Longhorns.
Former best player. I like how it's still current. UTSA's best player plays for. Yeah.
Did you see that quote? Yes. It was a Mac school. I can't remember who it was. And they were like, oh, like you don't have a good kicker. Like what's wrong with that? Why don't you have a good kicker? And he's like, yeah, we have a good kicker. He's getting some SEC school bought him off of us. He's getting paid to go kick for that school now. We have a kicker. He's just not here. It's cracking up, man.
Yeah, so essentially,
it seems like no love lost with Trey. They seem cool with him.
No, or at least they've been
professional about it. Trey's been around the program.
Not.
Like, you know, I got texts from people. He was at he's dating a UTSA soccer player, and he's like been at soccer matches, and everyone's cool with him. So
that's correct. That's nice. That's correct. Yeah, and so the Trey Moore, you know. Defensive player of the year, AAC, UTSA is an all-time leading sack holder in a season, single season. Not all-time, but single season, is it?
I think Marcus still has career.
Marcus still has all-time. So Trey Moore now on the other side of the field for UTSA, or for UT going against UTSA's number 25 ranked pass blocking offensive line, according to Pro Football Focus. I'm sorry, what number 120 in pass blocking, number 125 in run blocking, according to Pro Football Focus. It's going to be a really, really ugly day for UTSA's backfield. And, you know, just how much evil does Trey Moore have inside of him to just run through that Roadrunners offensive line and just destroy our ball carriers on every single snap? Because he's going to have the ability to. He's going to be able to burst through that line every single snap that he is in the game and likely, you know, commit first degree on a UTSA ball carrier. Is he going to exercise that to his full ability, or is he going to show mercy?
Right.
Will Trey Moore show mercy is the question.
Right. If he wanted to go, you know, full, sicko mode or whatever, he could get a sack every third play, I think.
Yeah, 14 sacks against the Roadrunners. Yeah.
Both of the offensive tackles are both transfers, right? So it's not like he's boys with them. Like, he'll throw them around like a rag doll and not have second thoughts about it. If he's going up against Corey Godinet or Finley Tatafu, he might have second thoughts. He's like, that's my guy, you know? Dang. But Kamar Missouri and Jalen Garth, you got another thing coming, brother.
Brutal. So, so the
it's an awkward time, right? It's like one thing to like watch a guy from your alma mater go to another school and like, wish him well, get your money, hope you get drafted, all that good stuff. But then to see them just a couple months later getting a sack. And sometimes they may have a degree from that school. I don't think Trey graduated from UTSA. I don't know. But it's awkward. It's really weird.
It's really weird. It's really awkward. It sucks, but it's a very wild dynamic that Trey Moore is now on the number two ranked Texas Longhorns, the number two team in the country, the highest ranked opponent UTSA will have ever played in their 14 season program history. Very appropriate that it's Big Brother, the UT Longhorns, right on the precipice of the UT Board of Regents deciding to put all of their time, attention, and resources into standing behind the commitment of UTSA being the next flagship behind UT Austin, merging with UT Health, and really dedicating, hey, we want UTSA to be all that it is. Then you get Big Brother to come in as the number two team and top in the country and just sort of topple you back down and say, hey, look, you're still UTSA, right? We're Austin and we call the shots here. And it's also a very stark difference, Jared, from almost 2 years ago to the date,
I know, right?
September 17th, 2022, UTSA led in the second quarter, 17-7, a 10-point lead over the Texas Longhorns against 102,000 fans in Darrell K. Royal Stadium. 2 years later, it's an extremely different situation for both the UT Longhorns and the UTSA Roadrunners. It's not going to be the same experience that you had whenever we hit that flea flicker down to who it was Brendan Brady to Zachary Franklin.
Zakari, yeah.
Yeah.
And by the way, quick shout out to Zakari. It was great to see him balling off for Illinois this past weekend and their upset win over Kansas. I've been waiting a long time to see that and hope he can keep it up. Or if he wants to transfer back to UTSA and
There's
find a
another
way to play another
crazy
year
Easter
as
egg
even
in there.
better.
There's another crazy Easter egg in there because wasn't Zakari on that team that we beat Illinois and it like
Yeah.
sort of like spearheaded the start of the trailer era, right? And here
Yeah.
he is back. And so it's like one of those weird full circle college football things. Yeah, love that.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, I mean, to make the comparison to the 2022 game, I think it was, I think it's more that Texas has gotten to where they always probably should have been because they were down that year, right? That was Sarkisian's first or second year. I don't know.
First, I
And
think.
he had to kind of rebuild that program, right? Like you wouldn't think a Texas Longhorn roster would be in bad shape, but it was in pretty bad shape, relative to their expectations. So I think it's not that UTSA has gotten a lot worse. Maybe they're like a bit worse than 2022. They're moderately worse than 2022. But I think Texas is a hell of a lot better than they were in 2022. This is a absolutely elite team. They have maybe the best quarterback in the country right now, in Quinn Ewers. He can make every throw. He can throw off the platform. He's got a great eye. He's had some interception problems throughout his career. He seems to have those under control. He seems to have perfect command of that offense, and he's just surrounded by weapons. And so, Steve Sarkisian is one of the most creative offensive minds in college football. He can scheme anyone open, right? I mean, I really feel like you could put Sarkisian with like San Jose State for 2 weeks, and he would find a way to put up 40 points against, Georgia, right? He's like a freak like that. But yeah, and the way that they've built, the five-star talent, especially on that offensive line, is incredible, right? I mean, they're just going to be a completely different team, and they is still bullied up on UTSA in that game, right? Those running backs really got going in that third and fourth quarter and, physically imposed their will. But now imagine that, and now they've got five-star offensive linemen when they had three or four-star before, right? It's going to be ugly. I have never had any kind of excitement or any type of inclination of traveling to Austin for this game this year, just because like I knew Texas was going to be this good. Like when they smoked Michigan this week, I didn't bat an eye. I mean, it's completely what I thought was going to happen. I thought they'd be national title contender this year, and they're well on their way.
Yeah, and it goes to speak of a lot of things, Jared. I'm the same. I was at that game whenever we went up 17-7 at DKR. It was a fantastic moment for UTSA fans to be standing up with all the Longhorns fans sitting down in that stadium. It was pretty surreal. But you also knew that the Roadrunners' high-flying offense was going to give you some good moments. You went into that game confident that you were going to see some great moments. Probably not going to happen this year. And it's not that the talent's out there, but UTSA just isn't there execution-wise to be able to see something like that happen. And the Longhorns are just so much better. They're going to mollywop us, but I still think it's great for all UTSA fans traveling. I hope you have a good time and get out there. We need you out there. We need the traveling contingency, but I'm sort of in the same boat, Jared. I won't be there. And look, UT, I think it's worth saying, yeah, they beat Michigan, the defending national champs, last week. It was also their very first win ever in the Big House. UT had never won in Ann Arbor before, which is pretty astounding. And so there's like them defeating like these great, superlatives in their history book. You get their first win in Ann Arbor. It's the first time you beat a reigning national champ since 1998. You're now not for the first time, not just you have the big narrative behind you for the first time in a long time for the Longhorns. Don't just have the big narrative behind you, but you're now getting the wins that justify that narrative. Everything seems to be falling in place for UT, who is completely striding. Yeah, there's Quinn Ewers in this game. The Longhorn fans are really excited about coming out, so that they can see a full second half of action from the prodigal from son, Archie Manning. Yeah, backup quarterback on the roster. Yeah.
Right. I think that's how this game is going to go, right? I think UT is going to get in control really early. I think UTSA will make some plays. I think Texas probably won't be as sharp as they were against Michigan. I think it'd be really hard for them to match that effort. But I still don't think it's ever going to be a scenario where there's any chance that UTSA is really going to put a scare into them like they did in 2022. I mean, in 2022, it didn't seem like that wild that they would have a chance to win with like some lucky bounces and stuff. But this year, no shot, man. I don't see it.
UT opens up as 30.5 point favorites. I think it's already up at 33.5, 34.5 maybe. So that line's probably only going to creep up throughout the week.
Yeah, very well justified. I saw it open at 30 somewhere, and it got up to 35 pretty quickly.
If we're losing 49-10 against Texas State, I hate to think what actual Texas is going to do to us. It's going to be an ugly game, Jared, but I think what the bigger picture is what does this do to the Roadrunners rest of the season, coming off an embarrassing loss over Texas State, and then getting whooped in Austin, UT. So you're in two hostile away games, back-to-back weeks, getting absolutely pummeled. Like, that is very much spirit-breaking, spirit-removing for the Roadrunners. I don't know how you can withstand that sort of emotional turmoil when nothing is working for you as a football team. And then you have a game against HCU, which you should win. It's HCU. Yeah, you're just going to win just off of talent alone. But we're not going to know who the hell these Roadrunners are until we have to face ECU in the conference opener. And that's now an extremely scary game on the schedule.
Well, Adrian, the pessimistic argument is we saw who this team was against Texas State last week. But we're just going to hope that that's not the case.
That's not the real Roadrunners, right?
That's the question I was going to ask you, though. Do you think it's better to like come off that bad loss, go in Austin, get stomped again, like an 80-point differential in 2 weeks combined? Or would it be better to have that Texas State loss? You have like kind of a tune-up game, you know, sorry to disrespect one of my favorite FCS programs in Houston Christian, but to like have an FCS tune-up game and then go and get smacked by Austin the next week? Or do you think like there's some benefit to having these two likely big losses back-to-back, getting them over with, and then kind of having a potential rebound game against Houston Christian? I can definitely see arguments for both. I think I prefer this scenario over the stagger one, though.
You definitely need them to happen back-to-back. Yeah, I think so. But my concern is with the back-to-back is this team getting psychologically beaten down so hard, so early in the year. I mean, sitting there at 1-2, but with two 30-point-plus losses, back-to-back weeks. Both happened on the road, so you're in hostile, crazy environments. You get back to the Alamo Dome, which will be empty, Jared, for Houston Christian University.
It'll be the lowest attendance
in a very long time, probably in the trailer era. And, well, and
I mean, Jared, outside of COVID year?
Yeah, outside of COVID,
it's probably going to be the lowest, yeah.
And, Jared, it's going to be hard to get fans back in that Alamo Dome after that loss to Texas State, period. I don't care who's coming to town. Even against a Memphis, it's going to be really hard to get fans to come out to this game, even 100%. If UTSA has done everything right.
You can beat ECU by 21. You can beat FAU by 17. You know, it doesn't matter, man. You've already made that impression to the casual fan. Attendance is shot for this year.
It is shot this year. Earning the trust back from casual fan to come back after a 49-10 loss to Texas State. That's probably a couple seasons worth of work. It is what it is. But
I think you're going to have families in New Braunfels like not go to the UTSA game they bought tickets for, and they're going to go check out a game in San Marcos. And you did that to yourself. You got no one to blame but yourself.
It's such a real example, Jared. Damn. It's such a real example.
And I can tell you this much. You're not going to pay $26 for two tacos and a Pepsi in USCU Stadium either.
No.
Get back on that train.
And, but it's serious, though. But it's serious. It's a serious issue because we've been around the program long enough to see that really good will for Alamo Dome attendance is very easily and very quickly severed, lost. And it takes a very long time to try and build it back after a very short thing that knocks it off. We still haven't reached season ticket numbers up to, you know, the end of the Coker year eras. And, you know, Jared, it's now something that these two back-to-back losses, this team hasn't played together. They're 1-2 with two 30-point-plus losses on the road. They get back to an empty Alamo Dome. I mean,
we're talking so like this is such a guarantee that they're going to lose by 30-plus. It's kind of funny.
It's sure as hell how it feels, doesn't it? I think you'd be foolish to think anything else. If you were a betting man, you wouldn't bet anything else.
Right.
And it feels like it could really sever this team's spirit. I don't know. Is it one of those things that goes back to UNT's drive of 2016 or 17? Is this a program altering loss on the timeline?
It could be. Absolutely.
It could be a 39-point loss to Texas State in this scenario, I think, has the potential to do something like that. Could unravel it all. I do think there's enough talent here, and Jeff Traylor is the coach to get the wheels back on. Yeah. But for UTSA fans to not be acting as if the wheels are completely off, I think is irresponsible as a fan, and probably irresponsible even for the staff of UTSA. I mean, you got to feel like this is really, really bad. We're only a couple of bad games away in 2024 from the wheels being totally off this thing. And I think a 500 finish for this team is wheels fully off to happen that quick. Yeah, I think it would be. So big picture outlook in a nutshell from me.
As far as the Texas game goes, you know, I think that the keys in this are not anything to do with the scores on the scoreboard. The key is to bring the triangle back. Resurrect that sucker up out of the ground. And you can still lose 52-0 like Colorado State did. But if you play tough Roadrunner football and you give perfect effort and you minimize mental mistakes and you look like a team that's proud of how they perform, I'm going to feel pretty good about them coming out and blowing out Houston Christian next week, about them coming out and, you know, going into Greenville, North Carolina, and coming out with a win against a really gritty team, and then going on and taking care of business with a pretty weak conference schedule, right? I still believe in that. As upset as I am by what I saw on the field on Saturday, I am not a doomer about this team just yet, right? And I think the first step is not to compete with Texas, but it's to compete with yourself, right? Get out there and run the football. You're probably not going to get 8 yards on run plays like you have against lesser opponents. But if you can get 3 or 4 and you get a couple holes here and there, that's what I'm going to see. I'm going to see guys in the right spot, playing hard, playing with effort, and executing a more limited playbook, right? But give me the Longhorns to win. I don't think they're going to play their best. So I'm going to say something like Texas okay, I'm going to do this. I'm going to say Texas 45, UTSA 10. So that would be a lesser point differential than Texas State had.
Say that Texas covers But I think you have a great point, Jared, about you just want to see this team play some inspired football. Are they checked in or are they checked out? And I think you'll be able to tell pretty early on, is this a team that's checked out of this game or are they playing inspired football with a will to win at least coming out of the gate? But I do think
at Texas, least be able to move the ball on their backups in the second half, right? That should be something to aspire to.
Right. And I think that's fair. But I do think Texas beats us up pretty good with their starters early on. I see it getting pretty out of hand. But UTSA does get some garbage time points against this team. So you can still give me Texas and you can give me, I do think we score a couple of garbage time touchdowns against their backups. I think UTSA does have a little bit of a resolve shown offensively, at least from Owen McGowan, right? I think he's going to show up and give us a little bit of something to be inspired by the end of the second half. So 17 points for the Roadrunners against 56 points for Texas. They're still going to cover and they're going to get up by very, very sizable. And Archie Manning will probably, and their backups and Archie Manning will probably still do some impressive things, I think, against us defensively. Sure. So, yeah, I've got 56-17 Longhorns. I still have Texas to cover.
Yeah, sounds good. Let's just get this week over with, man. I've never been less excited for week three in my life, I don't think.
Couldn't have said it better myself, Jared. Let's get this done. Get the hell out of here. We get back home to Houston Christian, try to beat them with a sizable difference, with some cohesion. And then we have to go on the road against East Carolina, which is going to be a very difficult game in Greenville for this team to stand up. The great news about that, though, is, Jared, is that this is a two-bye season. So you get a win over Houston Christian, you go play respectable, maybe get your first conference win over ECU, and then you go into a bye week. All this doom and gloom on this episode, Jared, it's erased kind of quickly. If you're sitting at 3-2 going into a bye week with 1-0 in conference, you still feel good about the season.
Kai Hart back. You have David Amador back. You got Donnie Taylor back. Maybe JT Clark back. It can be a whole new lease on life for these Roadrunners for sure. Do not count them out yet. They'd be foolish to do so.
So look at that. Look at that as a potential scenario that's very easy to happen coming out of a bye week. 3-2, 1-0 in the AC, a road game that feels like a home game at Rice coming out of that bye week. Yeah. There's a lot to be hopeful for, right? So hope in the triangle, resurrect the triangle. Yes, Jared.
All right, guys, well, we'll go ahead and wrap it up with a couple of extra Patreon shout-outs before we let you guys go. So I want to say thank you to all of our big money donors, Ben Tovar, the Bunch family. Got to meet them at the Texas State game, so thank you guys for saying hi. It's great chatting with you all. Zach Isberg, what's out the San Antonio Podcast Network, Alejandro Benavides, Dan Nerdall, host of Around the Bird Bath, Jacob Vasos, board president for the UTC Alumni Association, John Nally, Rick Cortez of Red Road Grillers, Sumner McDaniel, UTC King Bowser, Maddie, and lastly, Homefield Apparel, where you can use discount code UTSA once Homefield to get 15% off your first order. So thank you guys all so much. It's a long episode. Hope you guys made it this far. Shout out if you did. You're a real sicko. And we'll see you guys on Patreon this week. We're going to have our boy Eric Henry back on. He's now covering the Longhorns full-time on the beat for Horns 24/7. So really excited to catch up with Eric, hear how his life in Austin is going, and give you guys a little bit more insight to this very extremely impressive Longhorns roster. So we'll see you guys there if you're a Patreon subscriber. If not, we'll see you guys back next week to recap the game from DKR. So you guys take care.